What's up, guys? Landon here from the Full-Time Filmmaker team, and today we're taking a look at the next generation of the Ronin S, the DJI RS 2. Now, DJI has actually shortened the name, so although this new gimbal does say Ronin on the side, it won't be called the Ronin S 2, just RS 2. Now, I actually pre-ordered the original Ronin S a couple years ago when it was first announced, and I've used it for practically every shoot since I got it, so when DJI told us that they were releasing the second edition of the Ronin S and they wanted us to try it out, we obviously said yes, so even though we were one of the first to get our hands on this new gimbal, we are not being paid by DJI, so this is a completely unbiased review. They simply just provided us with this unit to test out. So I'll be going through some of the newest features and overall pros that I discovered with this gimbal, as well as talking about some of the minor cons that I found during my testing. And at the end, I'll give you my ultimate consensus on whether or not you should pick one of these up, and if I personally will be upgrading from my original Ronin S to the RS2. Now, to start out, let's talk about design. Now, if we set both of these gimbals up side by side, you'll see there are so many new things going on here with the RS2. And the most noteworthy, I think, are these new lightweight carbon fiber arms. It looks like DJI took a few of the design elements from the Ronin 2, their flagship gimbal system, which is designed for higher end cinema cameras. So it's nice they brought some of the luxury of that gimbal to the much smaller RS2. The overall footprint of this device is also quite a bit smaller than the original Ronin S. They've slimmed down practically everything, so it stands a little bit shorter, and part of that height difference is due to the new battery grip, which is about half the size and the weight. Yet it'll still give you 12 hours of battery life like the previous model, plus it now has fast charging, so it can be fully charged in just an hour and a half, so actually about 45 minutes faster than the Ronin S. They've also moved the position of the charging port, so now it's located directly on the battery. Strangely, one of my favorite new design features, because before, in order to charge it, you'd have to attach the battery grip to the gimbal, then plug it into the port right below the trigger, but now you can keep the gimbal in your bag and charge the battery separately. They've also redesigned a lot of other components that we saw on the original Ronin S. For example, the knobs that you use to set the balance of your camera have been upgraded, so they slide quite a bit more smoothly than before. They've also given the quick release plate a little bit of a makeover. It's still the same size as the previous model, but in case you're wondering, you can't use the old Ronin S plate on the RS2. And this is because they've added some teeth at the bottom of the dovetail plate, this big one here. So when you slide it onto your camera, you can precisely set the balance of your tilt axis by turning this little knob right next to the locking mechanism. On the Ronin S, it was just a little bit more difficult to slide your quick release plate into the exact position that you needed it. So that's a nice little feature that they've added. And they've actually given the RS2 two different quick release plates, the main dovetail that I just mentioned, plus this smaller quick release plate. So for example, this means that you could be shooting with the RS2, then quickly slide off the smaller release plate, shoot some handheld stuff, then quickly slide it back on without having to rebalance anything on your gimbal. In the combo package for the RS2, they include the same follow focus system that we saw on the original Ronin S, plus they give you a slightly taller quick release plate, which is just meant to give you more clearance when attaching your rails and focus motor. Another new feature they've added are these lock switches for each axis. This is something that the Ronin SC has that I think was missing on the original Ronin S, so I'm glad they included it on the RS2. They're designed a little bit differently than how we see them on the original Ronin SC. And to be honest, I kind of prefer the SC switches because they're a bit easier to find and switch. I feel like I have to fumble around a lot longer to find the switch on the RS2, unless I pick it up and I'm looking directly at it. Some people might not feel the same way, but at least they included them. Now, having these locks makes balancing a little bit easier because you can lock and manipulate specific axes for easier balancing. Plus, it makes traveling with this gimbal a bit more convenient, so I can quickly just lock it all up and throw it in my camera bag. They've also given the RS2 an all-new built-in full-color touchscreen that'll display the status of your gimbal, allow you to quickly change settings, auto-tune, switch shooting modes, modify your following speed, etc. And from what I can tell, any setting you might want to change can be accessed directly on the gimbal itself, so you won't need to be pulling out your phone as much as you used to. But as great as the new screen is, and it really is nice, it is a bit sensitive. When I was shooting with it, I kept accidentally touching it and changing changing settings, but thankfully DJI knew that would probably happen, so they added a feature that'll let you lock the screen by touching the power button once. So once you dial in your settings, they won't be changed by accident. A great perk of the new touchscreen is that it'll let you know if any of the motors are strained, thanks to this little icon up in the top right. So for example, if you're using a variable zoom lens like this 28-70, and you zoom in from 28 all the way to 70, the system will tell you that your motors are being strained, which you obviously don't want, since that will make your footage less stable and eventually lead to motor failure. A quick tip actually, if you're shooting on a variable zoom lens like the 28-70 and you want to switch focal lengths during your shoot, just zoom in to about the middle of those focal lengths. So if you're on a 28-70, that would be about 50 millimeters, and then balance your gimbal from there. So now on a 28-70, for example, you could go down all the way to 28 millimeters and then all the way up to 70 without putting too much strain on the motors. Now, another thing they've added is the new focus wheel that's built directly into the gimbal just above the trigger. I'm actually a really big fan of this redesign because, unlike the old one, you can operate the gimbal with one hand and adjust your focus simultaneously. You can also change the function of the dial in case you'd rather have it adjust your camera's ISO, aperture, or the gimbal's roll. So a nice little feature there. And by the way, if you like the old focus wheel, DJI has kept the same RSA connectors on the sides of the gimbal, so you'll still be able to use your old focus wheel or any other accessories that use that connection. But thanks to all of these design features, specifically those carbon fiber arms and the lighter battery, the overall weight of the RS2 has been slimmed down quite a bit, exactly 2.86 pounds actually, which is more than a pound lighter than the original Ronin S and only about half a pound heavier than the old Ronin SC. But even though it is lighter than its predecessor, they've enhanced the motor so you actually have a higher payload capacity. Now, it's been tested to carry 10 pounds, a little bit of an upgrade from the 8-pound weight limit on the original Ronin S. This means I could fly one of my heavier setups on the RS2 without any issues. One of the biggest drawbacks for me on the original Ronin S was its payload capacity. And even though I could balance and fly my 1DX on it, it clearly put a good amount of strain on the motors, and I've actually replaced it twice in the past 2 years due to motor failure. So hopefully with the upgraded payload capacity, we'll also see an improvement in the overall reliability. I do want to note though that even though the RS2 technically can carry more weight, it doesn't automatically mean your heavy setup will actually fit on here. I stripped down our Red Dragon to see if it would work on the RS2, and I think eventually if you use some counterweights and you spend enough time trying to get it to work, it would probably fit. And ironically, the only thing that seems to be holding it back from working is actually a very minor design change that DJI has made. I can balance all of the axes except the roll. Now on the old Ronin S, you could adjust this back arm and this piece right here, but on the RS2, they obviously still have the adjustable back arm right here, but there's no way to slide your camera left and right to give you that extra wiggle room if you're using a big setup. So if DJI had kept that extra sliding piece on there, then I'm confident the Red would have fit, so just a slight downside there. And by the way, if you're wondering, even though the Ronin S could technically balance the Red on the roll axis, it wouldn't fully carry it because the arm that connects to the tilt axis right here is a little bit shorter than the arm on the RS2, so ironically, neither gimbal would be able to handle it. Speaking of payload and motors, DJI has also changed their stabilization algorithm, which is basically the programming behind the motors which allow you to get smooth shots. And to be honest, I've always thought that the stabilization on the original Ronin S was already pretty good, but regardless, DJI has upgraded the algorithm, so we went out and tested both the old Ronin S and the new RS2 to see if we could even tell a difference. We put the exact same camera setup on each gimbal, balanced them perfectly, auto-tuned them, and we did not change any of the settings inside the Ronin app, so everything was just on default. Now, side by side, they look almost the same, but I will say that the RS2 does seem to be just a touch more stable than the Ronin S. Again, not a huge difference by any means, and yes, I am aware that there is a certain level of user error in each clip, so it's not a perfect comparison, but regardless, I think it's safe to say that the new algorithm is, in fact, an improvement from its predecessor, something I didn't even really know we needed, but DJI gave it to us anyway. There's also a new feature called Super Smooth, so if you have a heavier setup and a really tight focal length, apparently you can activate that and get an even higher level of stabilization. I did a couple of tests with the 1DX2 at 200 millimeters to see how it would hold up, and I was actually pretty surprised, especially in these clips where I'm parallaxing around my subject. Apparently the Super Smooth feature works by increasing the motor's capacity and torque, giving you a bit of a boost from the standard motor strength. DJI has also launched the Raven Eye image transmission system for the Ronin, which essentially broadcasts your camera's image to both the Ronin app and even the touchscreen on the gimbal. So on big productions, this technology definitely comes in handy in case you want to monitor your camera remotely. Normally, you'd need to buy a separate wireless HDMI system to do this, but with Raven Eye, it's all integrated within DJI's product ecosystem. So the module attaches directly to your gimbal, and like I said, you can view your camera's image directly in the Ronin app, and you can even change your camera's settings if your camera is hooked up to the RS2 via the RSS port, giving you what's honestly an amazing all-in-one system. One of the pros of having your camera plugged into the RS2 with that RSS port is that now you have a much more accurate tracking system. When they introduced ActiveTrack 3.0 on the Ronin SC, you used to have to attach your phone to the top of your camera in order to use it, which was honestly just a huge pain because it made your camera top heavy. Plus, in this position, your phone's camera is viewing the scene at just a slightly different angle than your actual camera, so it just wasn't an ideal system. But now with Raven Eye, ActiveTrack 3.0 uses the actual image from your camera's sensor, so the tracking is naturally just more accurate. Also, going back to the Ronin SC, when we reviewed that gimbal last year, we were kind of bummed that you couldn't actually see the image from your camera while using the Mimic or Force Mobile feature. So on the original Ronin SC, this made it feel like it was just kind of a half-baked feature, but with Raven Eye, because you can actually see what your camera is seeing and use Force Mobile simultaneously, it makes it a much more versatile and practical Mimic system. And speaking of versatility, DJI has also added a few design tweaks to give the RS2 a bit more functionality in different shooting scenarios. One of the main things they've done is upgraded the RSA ports on the side of the gimbal to be NATO compatible, so basically they can transfer data and they double as rails for different accessories. So technically you could mount some NATO handles to the side, or the included briefcase handle as they call it, which gives you the ability to more easily put the camera into low mode. I'm a big fan of this as opposed to a stationary handle that's there all the time like you would find on other gimbals, since most of the time I'm going to be shooting with it upright and it would honestly just get in the way. They've also created a vertical mounting plate, so you're actually able to just slide the plate that's attached to the tilt axis right off the gimbal and replace it with the vertical plate, so you wouldn't need an L bracket if you do a lot of vertical shooting. DJI has also created another kit that you can purchase with what's called a universal base mount, so you can mount the RS2 to practically anything like a jib, a car, slider, cable cam, etc. Unfortunately, they didn't actually have this kit ready for us to try out, but I did see a quick photo of it and it looks really promising, so if you do a lot of versatile shooting, I think this would be a pretty big selling point for the RS2. Alright, so you've heard all the specs and now you just want to know if you should be picking one of these up. I think personally, if you currently do not own any sort of gimbal, but you're on the market for one and you shoot on a DSLR or a mirrorless camera of some kind, even if you plan on upgrading at some point to a bigger camera, I think the RS2 is a really good buy. And I promise I'm not just saying that, this is a gimbal that should last you for a long time. And like I've already shown you, it's an extremely versatile piece of equipment, so you can rig it up in so many different ways with so many different cameras. So even if you shoot on a smaller camera now, but you plan on upgrading in the future, the RS2 is a pretty safe bet because it'll accommodate the majority of cameras that you'll come across in your filmmaking career. So again, if you're on the market for a gimbal that'll last you for a while, I'd recommend the RS2. Now, if you already own the Ronin S or another gimbal, honestly, I'm gonna let you decide based on your situation if it's worth the upgrade. If you're unhappy with your current gimbal, then yes, I think the RS2 would be a pretty good purchase. But if your current gimbal is working just fine, it's giving you smooth footage, I don't think you'd need to upgrade unless you feel like you could directly benefit from any of the design updates that DJI has made, like the better portability, the higher payload capacity, the wireless video transmission with Raven Eye, etc. If those features are important to you, then yes, I do think you should upgrade. As we've seen, the overall stabilization has improved, but personally, not enough for me to switch just for that reason. I'll most likely be getting one just because of the size. The fact that I can just fold it up and throw it in my bag is awesome. The convenience of the built-in screen is a huge selling point for me as well. The weight, because it's a lot less strain on my arms and back if I have to shoot all day. So for those reasons, I'll probably be getting one. So look at all the specs, rewatch this video if you have to, and determine whether or not the RS2 checks off enough boxes for you. As we've proven over and over with our beginner versus pro series, good gear and software will definitely help you in your video creation, but honestly, what's more important are the skills behind that equipment. That's why we created Full-Time Filmmaker, an online film course with over 17,000 students and constantly growing. Our private Facebook group has nearly 14,000 1,000 members, and it's considered to be one of the most valuable parts of joining the course. You can post your work, get feedback from other members, even find a mentor that can help you accelerate your learning curve. Right now, we have well over 400 concise, informative, no-fluff tutorials to quickly teach you anything and everything you need to know about making high-quality videos. And we're always adding to it, taking requests from our students, and tackling topics that they want to learn. So if you're serious about video creation and you want to turn it into a career, hit the link right here. Or if you're still on the fence, you can watch our completely free 1-hour filmmaking training by clicking down here. But that's it for this video. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and if you have any further questions, please let us know.